Pablo Bronstein back, and in the company of Alice Rawsthorn. Pablo will be known to all of you by now, at least partly, through the extraordinary exhibition upstairs that he's curated and created. And I hope you'll also get the chance during the run of the show to see his exhibition that's the flip side of this project at Chatsworth House, which is an exhibition of many of his drawings. Pablo divides his time between London and the great East Kent town of Deal, and was born in Argentina in the late 70s, grew up in Neasden in suburban London, and in my opinion is one of the best British artists of his generation. He's had solo exhibitions at the Metropolitan Museum in New York. I think he was the youngest ever to have that honor. At the ICA in London, at Red Cat in Los Angeles, at the Centre d'Art Contemporain in Geneva, and in December he'll have an exhibition at Museo Marino Marini in Florence. Around half his work takes the form of drawings or etchings, and should you feel inclined, he's made the most beautiful hand-painted edition print available upstairs, which is a source terrine in the shape of Chatsworth House. And he also makes work that takes the form of books, performances, usually using trained classical dancers, and public artworks. If you're anywhere near Folkestone, do see his beach hut in the style of Nicholas Hawksmoor, which is a wonderful public artwork, and surrounded by the actual sherbet-coloured beach huts that were there, and has done performances, commissioned performances at Tate Modern, Artissima in Turin, Frieze Up, and many other places. It's also a great delight to welcome Alice Rawsthorn here, someone we've really wanted to have speak in our public programme for some time, and many of you will know her work, her writings on design, currently for the International New York Times, and they're syndicated around the world. She really is a world authority on design. Has a column in Frieze. Prior to the New York Times, she was director at the Design Museum for 5 or 6 years, from 2001. And is now chair of the Chisenhale Gallery in Mile End, and a trustee of the Whitechapel Gallery and the Michael Clark Dance Company. She wrote an acclaimed biography of Yves Saint Laurent, which I really hope I'll have time to get round to one day. And her most recent book was Hello World, Where Design Meets Life, which explores design's influence on our lives, past, present, and future. And last year, she was honored with an OBE for services to design. So welcome to both Alice and Pablo, who will speak together for some 40 or 45 minutes, and then we'll turn over to questions. When we do, if you could wait for the roving mic to go around, because we'll be recording, filming this talk and archiving it online. And then, after questions, if you would like to stay around for a short while and talk further to our speakers, we will have a small bar set up here. This is a bit of an innovation, because by then the cafe will be closed, so do join us for a drink after. Okay, thanks very much.
Well, thank you very much, Alex, and to all of you for coming here on this slightly drizzly evening here in Nottingham. I'm very excited to be here because, not least, as I'm a huge fan of Caruso St. John, the architects, I've been very curious to see the building ever since it was built, and also the exhibitions. You're so lucky here to have such a great exhibition programme. And this exhibition in particular, I'm sure you'll agree, is sensational. And so I'm going to begin by asking Pablo about the Grand Tour exhibition here at Nottingham Contemporary and also its counterpart at Chatsworth House, and then we'll talk more generally about his work and his preoccupation with design and architecture and their relationship to art before we open it up to questions. So Pablo, if I could begin, how did this exhibition come about?
I was asked by, am I on the microphone here? I can't tell. I was asked by Alex Farquharson, the director, to essentially bridge the two venues, Chatsworth House and Nottingham. We were looking at bringing objects from Chatsworth to Nottingham and to try to create exhibitions that were, in a sense, bridging both venues in both venues. They mapped out slightly differently in practice. In practice, the exhibition at Chatsworth is a series of my works, the sort of works that you might see in a museum, in a museum exhibition dedicated to my work. Show in Nottingham is really a sort of conversation between me and the objects that I selected, with a good deal of help from a whole load of people.
So how much freedom were you given in developing the concept for the exhibition? I mean, it is so appropriate to you and your work that I had assumed that you were invited to do an exhibition here and this was the concept you'd come up with. So, but was it the case that Nottingham Contemporary and Chatsworth were planning a collaboration and it was part of the Grand Tour broader regional project?
I think that was actually quite symbiotic. I mean, perhaps Alex is actually better placed to answer that one, but I'm fairly certain that in thinking about whether this show was possible, they needed to know whether they probably had a very few artists in mind in order to be able to bridge the two institutions. Because what I think was necessary for this show is a certain amount of respect for the objects that Chatsworth has. It's not a sort of head-on collision between, you know, contemporaneity and antique fragments. I feel that I'm getting a sort of large sort of feedback loop. Is that, are you?
Slightly. Yeah. Why don't we leave it that if the audience can't hear us, just shout, and otherwise we'll blithely assume that you can.
I wonder if this is better. Does this sound better? Yeah. I think what I tried to do was to bring in criticality in quite a gentle way. I tend to have a sort of a way of being critical, which is to very often, well, I don't know how critical it is, but I tend to overpraise things very often. So rather than have very discreet showing scenic devices, i.e. very elegant sort of plinths for things and spotlights on them, you know, very, very sort of museum worthy constructions around an object, I tend to ham it up. And there is a sense of criticality in that to the contemporary art museum goer, they will pick up on that, but that it allows a certain amount of breathing space so that it doesn't feel like I'm essentially laughing at the objects or laughing at Chatsworth, which I'm not interested in doing.
And were you familiar with Chatsworth when you began work on the project? Had you been there and did you know the collection well?
I had never been there before. This process was like pulling teeth. I mean, the amount of meetings and conversations we had about the objects was really unbelievably complicated. Not only in terms of the amount of objects that they have available. By the way, I should say they were extremely generous. They basically said you can have anything you want. But nonetheless, that's a problem of its own because, of course, you know, where do you start? The question of how you show objects, whether some objects are sort of perhaps too fragile to show, or whether they are too expensive to bring over, or whether they cost too much money to move, whether they are too popular within Chatsworth, so that if, for example, you paid your ticket to go and see Chatsworth House and that object was now no longer there, whether you would, you know, complain. All of these issues came up and they were quite a learning curve.
And so what were your criteria for choosing the objects? And I should point out to those of you who haven't been to Chatsworth that it is quaking with old master paintings, extraordinary historic furniture, and objects, decorative art objects of different types, because over the generations, the family have been avid collectors, and they have certain family rituals. So to this day, there's always a portrait of the Duchess of Devonshire, for example. And I think the former Dowager Duchess who died last year, that was a Lucian Freud portrait. Michael Craig Martin did the portrait of the future Duchess. So there's an enormous amount to choose from many different periods. So what were your criteria in terms of selecting the objects to bring here?
Well, I was quite selfish in a way. I wanted to concentrate on objects that interested me for a couple of reasons. In other words, I didn't go for objects that were entirely representative of Chatsworth. I didn't go for personal effects. I didn't go for sort of nostalgia. I didn't go for anything that really spoke of very recent Chatsworth history, which is actually the Chatsworth that people know and love. You know, Devo Devonshire is a huge reason for going to Chatsworth. Her merchandise, as you rightly pointed out, sells an awful lot. I think what my criteria were, first, personal taste. I had to like the object. And I think pretty much all of the objects are things that I would very, very happily own, except for the thrones. Just because modesty, you know, for this.
And they are rather vulgar.
They are, indeed. But the other criteria was that I was trying to create a narrative around the early formation of Chatsworth House, not the sort of Renaissance incarnation, but the Chatsworth House that we can see. The images that are on the wall in Gallery 3, those images are versions of Chatsworth House cleaned of its 18th and 19th century additions. These are sort of, it's a late 17th century nugget, and a nugget with a very easily identifiable parade room circuit, or a route through the house. And the objects that I chose were, or are intimately connected with display, with power, with the perspectives that power needs in order to have its effect, things that are at the end of vistas, like the thrones, things that are in a series of variations, like the Delft pyramids that continue throughout the house and add a sense of accumulated wealth. So those are the objects that I was interested in, with a general aesthetic to the late 17th, early 18th century. There are exceptions to this, but generally speaking, it talks about a moment in, the objects talk about a moment in the history of the house and of English, certain sorts of English aristocracy, of unbridled optimism, of unashamed display of wealth, and the culture that they wanted to acquire from the continent, which is why it ties in a little bit to the Grand Tour theme.
But is that your interpretation, or did you do research to analyse which member of the family had bought those objects and why, and what was happening to them in their life at that particular time? Or is this how you imagine the spirit of their acquisition?
Mostly it was research that I didn't do, but that other people did. The Chatsworth people know very, very well who bought what, and they mostly relate to the acquisitions that were made by the first Duke. There are some later additions. Some of these bits and pieces were, you know, they look the part. For example, the wine cistern, the gold-plated one, isn't late 17th century, but it's in the late 17th century style. It was just made 100 years later to fit into a scheme or something. I'm not quite sure why it was made in the 1770s or 80s, I think. That sort of stuff I brought in as set pieces.
So within these criteria of the historic period, the notion of exemplifying power, extravagance, optimism, and also the notion of vistas being pieces that would be visual focal points in the house, where did you begin? Which were the first pieces that you decided to include?
Silver and Delft are for me extremely emblematic of this stuff. Silver is a material that creates or is transformed into objects that are literally depositories of wealth. And not only depositories of wealth, but aimed at display. So, for example, the pilgrim flasks, the very, very large bottles with stoppers and chains coming down, these are objects that are not meant for use. They are meant to contain material wealth, i.e. the cost of the silver, and to be seen as luxury objects. The silver was one, the Delft was another, both extremely impressive objects for their time. They're also objects that contain a huge amount of design information, and they are up to date because of the beginnings of transcontinental trade, as in the Delft, or because of the beginning of plate books and their exportation into England. Silver is able to very, very quickly take the shape of current fashions, unlike, for example, other sorts of objects that you would replace in a far more cumbersome way. So these are objects that would be immediately made up on the receipt of a plate book by a silversmith, and they are in a good style for the time. They're not necessarily that clumsy or that provincial, given that they're in Derbyshire in the 1780s, which you would expect.
Well, possibly, but if you think of the influence of Huguenot silversmiths on British silversmithry, I mean, as you've rightly pointed out, these were portable items which were of great iconographic significance as well as considerable value, but also their makers were itinerant as well, and they did come to Britain in large numbers and
That's
had a
right.
significant
That's
influence
right.
here. So it was one of our earliest sort of cosmopolitan crafts, in a way.
Exactly, but the level is really pretty, I mean, good. I mean, if, for example, we take very decent quality English furniture of 1680 or so, this stuff, in terms of its sort of overall effect and its technique, could not compete with the French court, for example. But the silver, I think, probably could. It's pretty impressive stuff.
And can we talk about the display of the objects? Because you've obviously commissioned two very imposing display devices in the little sort of temple in which the silverware, the plate, is placed, and then the large cabinet in which the Delftware is displayed. And you alluded earlier to the importance of display in your work, and how sometimes you will make it deliberately kitsch. Whereas those display devices aren't kitsch at all. They're rather elegant, in fact, as long as you don't look at them too closely.
Yes. I mean, they are elegant, but they're not elegant within a contemporary art discourse. I mean, within a contemporary art discourse, a fiberglass column is in the world of kitsch. They may be elegant if they were seen at Chatsworth House, and perhaps that is a contextual conversation that I'm sort of exploiting. In fact, I think that, am I right in saying that Chatsworth House actually want to take these displays back and to use them potentially for similar objects, which I think is quite interesting.
And if we then move to the Boule furniture that is in the next gallery and is placed on the sort of central plinth, you can see the back of some of the, there are two marquetry cabinets, and then there's a larger cabinet by an unknown craftsman. And so you can compare the very exquisitely crafted ornate fronts to the really quite clumsy, dodgily constructed backs. I mean, can you explain why you took that decision?
I think the decision was less about how these bits of furniture were constructed than about making you feel that you would be, that you are essentially looking out, sorry, you are looking in through glass walls into a room. So it would be like the sort of fourth wall of the theatre. I think there's probably a relation to the Back of the Thrones, for example. There is a comment about power, but I haven't really wanted to go entirely, you know, full throttle about that.
So when you say a comment about power, do you mean in terms of the element of deconstruction?
The theatre involves in power and how it images itself, you know.
And could we talk about the choice of the old master drawings and the paintings? Because with the drawings in particular, I mean, collecting what we now called old master drawings is something that we now associate with great wealth, but they wouldn't have been very grand, magnificent or imposing sort of trophy pieces at the time. And some of them, the content and execution is deeply eccentric. There's a wonderful... I think it's Giulio Romano, the drawing of the stream, which is this sort of fantastical depiction, almost of a whirlpool with creatures sliming out of it.
Mm. Well, the Romano, I think Chatsworth think that it is a design for a silver basin. But yes, I very much take your point. I haven't gone for the Raphaels and the Leonardos that they have in their collection. I've gone for quite eccentric pieces.
Sharing restraint.
Yes, exactly. That would have been vulgar. but one of the things I think I tried to do was use some of the drawings to tell small narratives. So that there are two sequences that are, I think are particularly that I particularly use drawings to do that with. One is a sequence that has three. I want to. Am I able to? How do I do this? Do I push up? Escape. Sorry, I don't have escape. Oh, yeah. So, and then there's this thing at the bottom. Okay. So there are these, for example, these three drawings. This is, they help tell it in very sort of, in a way, kind of idiotic terms, an idea that I sort of follow through, which. That connects the three drawings in a sort of funny narrative that it's got nothing to do with any sort of original intentions. But this, for example, is an image of architecture that uses the human figure as an ornament. It's, of course, sculptural, but nonetheless, the human figure is there, gives the scale. It's used entirely sort of as a little icon, basically. This one, it is a design for a trompe l'oeil fresco decoration in which a figure is seen somehow escaping or walking through or out of the architecture. And this one is the Guercino, or Caracci, I'm not quite sure who did it, is a woman looking at architecture or being seen against an architectural background that two drawings previously she would have been embedded within, and now she is a separate entity. Now, that isn't anything to do with the actual drawings, but I think I've used them to sort of tell a little narrative. Here we've got the very, very impressive Peter Lely sketch of the first Duke in full court regalia. This is Grinling Gibbon's cravat that has been taken off a portrait. And here is the Rembrandt drawing of the actor in his dressing room. So another little narrative about the theatrics of power and undressing and so
So, and the paintings, you have the Franz Hals, the smirking rather than the laughing cavalier. Did they also tell a particular, do they have a narrative strand, or did you have different reasons for choosing them?
How do I put this back on? The main circle in the middle, yeah. So the Franz Hals is, I think, quite important in the show because it is a sort of a moment of quite close proximity with something that is recognisably human, which I think Franz Hals is quite keen to show. I mean, in a way, the ruff and the shirt and all of the accoutrements are nicely painted, but we don't like them because we don't like that painting because the ruff is quite nicely done. We like it because there's a very sort of immediate facial recognition, and so I wanted that, and I hung it fairly low, and I wanted that sort of immediate human connection. Mostly, I think, because I was interested in another side of the 17th century, which is a kind of skull-holding John Donne side of it, a kind of an inner angst moment or melancholia. The Salvator Rosa, I think I was interested in partly because it's about a dream and partly because it's about a pretty wild landscape. And I think that I don't know if you agree, but I think that the sort of landscape is a sort of projection of another kind of dream state. We've got the sort of official angel stuff on the left-hand side of where the person is dreaming a ladder going up to heaven, but next to it is a far more dreamlike, odd environment. And so I wanted to bring that in.
And the works that you have produced for the exhibition here of the Appian Way in Rome, could you talk about those and why you decided to do them and what role you feel they play in the exhibition? I mean, we can see them behind the thrones here.
The Appian Way is a site that throughout the 17th, 18th and 19th century was meticulously documented by grand tourists, by people going to Rome and making sophisticated drawings of them or trying to measure it up. And in the late 18th century, Piranesi made some unbelievably fantastic and outrageous drawings of the Appian Way, completely fanciful. The Appian Way is a very long road leading out from Rome that has Roman funerary monuments that line it. This very long series of drawings is entirely fabricated. So the temples are that these tombs are, they're a mixture of anything from Etruscan to fin de siècle Parisian architecture. But I think it's a sort of chop through. So a lot of these buildings are actually sort of very immediate. This in a line, I think, was quite lent itself to the Appian Way, a sort of consistent interrupting of buildings in a continual line made sense. I was interested, I think, in death and decay, but in a particular moment of death and decay, a moment when things are still visible, the colour is still on the statues. And I think that the idea that this trying to communicate is that power is finite, that we imagine that things go on forever, and then the evidence all around us is that things don't.
And is the Grand Tour, the notion of the Grand Tour, of it wasn't universally men who went, but principally sort of cultured young men who would go to Rome, to Italy and Greece and be inspired by the ancient monuments that they saw there. Is this something that has a strong appeal for you that you've always been interested in?
The actual Grand Tour, I think, is inevitable source material if you are interested in anything that is 17th, 18th, or 19th century, because everything sort of essentially passes through there. The architects that you might be looking at studied there, or whatever it might be. But I think that within my Appian drawing, it's all quite lower middle class in a way, and I enjoy that. I mean, I grew up in Neasden, and
which you have described as a crappy suburb on several occasions.
It is. There is no saving it, you know. But for example, there is next to the bathtub, there is a yellow tomb and a red tomb, and it's a sort of, it's kind of keeping up with the Joneses type thing, because either the yellow or the red would be, if we had them today, magnificent relics from ancient Rome. Not that they are in an ancient Roman style, but they would be magnificent. But the fact that you've got both is a little bit like saying, well, you know, the neighbours have a yellow one, so we're going to have a red one, you know. Mm-hmm. There's a touch of the competitive about it all, which I find really fascinating, and an exact opposite to Chatsworth House, which is in the middle of nowhere, you know, surrounded by absolutely nothing. It's too unique and special somehow.
But the Grand Tour wasn't simply an indulgence for the rich and a sort of very extravagant antique shopping spree. Yeah. I mean, it was seen as an essential part of the education of anyone who wanted to engage in visual culture. So, for example, William Kent, who obviously was one of the most gifted, certainly landscape architects that Britain has ever produced, came from a very humble family, I think, in Grimsby, and his father persuaded wealthy local people to sponsor Kent's Grand Tour so he could go there and make his name, acquire knowledge, and eventually sort of make his fortune and become an extraordinary cultural figure in Britain. Exactly the same thing happened to John Soane. So it was an intensely serious educational endeavour as well.
Mm.
Does that side of it appeal slightly less to you?
I'm not an academic, you know, and I'm not an antiquarian in that sense. So I think what I'm very interested in when images of the Grand Tour go wrong. I think far more interested in corruption and the classical tradition being twisted somewhat. So two bits or three that spring to mind are Talman, John Talman, the architect mm-hmm. of Chatsworth House. He came back from the Grand Tour with the most bonkers Italian style architecture, stuff that you would never see. I mean, it feels more sort of 16th century Scandinavian, really, than anything else. Just weird shells and stuff stuck on, a real mess. I love that sort of miscommunication somehow, or things that he was looking at that clearly blew his mind, but somehow he was unable to communicate. Or Piranesi and his gang that had a line in dodgy rip-off merchandise that they were selling off to the likes of these dukes that were entirely spurious, so they would sort of join. The British Museum still has a whole room of them, I think, of random lumps that they would turn into magnificent urns, and people would find it very difficult to unpick what was real, what was fake, and they would just sort of. So those things I'm far more interested in than, for example, people accurately, in a very sort of Ecole de Rome way, measuring what. Think how the Parthenon was really constructed, which is of little interest to me.
And you have now absolutely nailed a leitmotif of whenever you talk about the things that really appeal to you and your passions, there's a perversity that runs through them, whether that's by recontextualizing them or in the particular angles that you pick up on. There were many other aspects of Piranesi's work that you could have chosen, but this particularly picaresque incident was one. So how important is perversity in your work? I mean, for example, would you be interested in these objects, I mean, some of which are exquisitely crafted, like these Delft pyramids, others like the hideously vulgar thrones, less so. But would you be interested in them if you weren't decontextualizing them and putting them in the White Cube of Nottingham Contemporary?
I think that's a very big question. And I mean, generally speaking, I'm a contrarian, but entirely instinctively. And so I don't deliberately aim to be that, but I just am, and I happen to like it that way. I think that I resist the fuddy-duddy world of, you know, the Quinlan Terrys, of you know, Kundantari is a sort of imitator of classical architecture, basically, extremely boring figure in a way. And that world would probably take me quite happily. But I, you know, I'm not part of that world. And so my interest in it is always in juxtaposition with the white wall, always. In fact, when you see some of my drawings in Chatsworth, because they are within antique frames, within antique-y settings, they dissolve into a world which they find very difficult to resist, or it becomes extremely sticky. There's a moment in the old master drawing room where I have a work, and it feels quite vertiginous to me to walk in there, because I'm not entirely sure I can identify my work in it. Not that my work is like old master drawings, because in fact they don't have that many, it's more sort of knickknacks, and there's a fantastic Rembrandt, but they've got cabinets of various other bits and pieces. But I sort of feel like I'm falling in, which I find deeply alarming.
That and also very honest of you, because I suspect most artists would want their work to prevail, particularly for themselves. It sounds as though you see the work as less being subversive in that context, as somehow sort of seduced by it.
I think so, yes. There's a very complicated question around conservatism to be had, which I think depends entirely on context, as all these questions.
Radicalism.
Exactly. And so, you know, I think that's probably for another day, but the work feels or needs to feel you know what, I actually can't finish that sentence because it's not easy without a
we move on swiftly to the Chatsworth exhibition so you can describe what you've done there and why.
The show at Chatsworth is a very sort of classic hang of drawings of mine, mostly around the themes of construction, architecture, basically.
And these were pre-existing drawings, you
didn't
do them specially?
They are, they're a series of loans, yeah. But there is a drawing in the old master drawing room, which is a kind of it's an object that curates, it's a drawing that tells you how to hang the Rembrandt that's in that room in a sort of different kind of setting. And so the Rembrandt that you have next to the drawing gives you the sense of scale for the architecture. But they are, in Chatsworth, they're all the drawings are about architecture or interior design, except for two of the drawings are designs for crockery, and one of the drawings is a view of Paris.
So let's go back to the beginning and where your interests and obsessions came from. I mean, I read in an interview with you that when you were 16 and living in Neasden, you decorated your bedroom like a Baroque palazzo, which must have been something of a shock to your parents, or maybe not. So is this fascination with the Baroque, and is this something that has been present for you for many, many years? I mean, it certainly has been for all the time I've known you and been aware of your work.
Yes, I think so. I mean, I have to say that I've gone through phases of being a cubist and of doing other things, but I've always gone back to highly elaborate worked surfaces. But my interest in the Baroque and all of this sort of extremely fancy culture is mostly through quite pop culture that I get it from, really. So, for example, the room that I decorated in Neasden was really, I think, looking through my mother's interior decoration magazines. Probably I was dumbstruck by the work of Timney Fowler, who, Sue Timney, by the way, lives in Deal. things like that I was looking at, or cartoons I would be obsessed by, especially cartoons that featured, you know, ye olde Baroque worlds. Especially, I think I associate the Baroque with a certain kind of evil that I find extremely seductive.
But it's a very sort of pantomimesque evil, isn't it? It's
yes.
Dick Dastardly with a twirling moustache.
I played the ugly sister in a version of Cinderella in the school play when I was six.
Clearly, everything changed from then onwards. But did you, as a child and as a teenager, did you go to environments, buildings, spaces, or see works of art that had a particularly profound impact on you? Or was it much more sort of mediated information, like your mum's interiors magazine?
Well, most of it was really mediated, but my parents being, you know, 60s-ish intellectuals, you know, had a Picasso book. I think that a lot of it is also, again, it's quite contextual. I think that the growing up in Neasden in the 80s was a grim world of aluminium windows and, you know, knackered out cars and occasionally a cul-de-sac with a new bunch of, you know, prefab houses. If we were lucky, we had something to look at like that. I was born in Argentina. My grandmother had a very sort of camp house, beautifully done in the sort of 50s and then never touched, with chandeliers and mirrors and all of the sort of fancy accoutrements that a doctor and his wife would decorate their house with in Latin America. You know, you'd buy the silver cockerels fighting each other and all of that stuff. And
did you go back there regularly, or did you have very vivid memories of it?
Vivid memories, but we did go back quite a lot, every 2 or 3 years. And the difference between that sort of faded resplendence and our two-up-two-down in Easton was really quite shocking. You know, looking back at the house that we grew up before my parents did the loft extension, it was a very, very small house, you know.
And so did you have a sense that you had been sort of wrested away from a superior destiny?
Probably, actually, yeah. I mean, there's no other word. Yes, I think so.
So it's been a mad scramble to recreate it.
A little bit.
Ever
but
since.
It's created, I mean, in a way, I'm relatively aware. I mean, I sort of feel quite split in some senses. I have to laugh. This work is obviously slightly sort of self-humorous. I mean, I placed a little drawing of mine that I made in 2005 in between these enormous computer versions of Chatsworth House. So there is a little bit of mockery as well as huge amounts of narcissism.
And has the mockery always been there? I mean, you're entirely serious about your work. I mean, I also read that when you were at the Slade, you devoted your entire final year to one painting, which may be a slight exaggeration.
No, it's really true.
It is.
Yeah, it's true.
And what was that of?
It was, again, it was an architectural painting. But if I had been allowed to just draw, I would have made that in a week. You know, part of the problem, why it took so long and why I absolutely do not paint, is because it's impossible to get a straight line with a brush.
And you did begin by studying architecture for a couple of months before art school.
I did a couple of months at the Bartlett. I always thought I wanted to be an architect. At first I wanted to be a jeweller and then I wanted to be an architect. Mostly because I was in love with the subject matter. I mean, I don't know what your childhood was, but I found it very, very difficult to distinguish between what I liked and what I wanted to be, you know.
Right. Well, and why should you have to distinguish between those two things why did you give up architecture?
It's a very, very difficult profession. I realised that it is too negotiated, and fundamentally you have a client always. I think that's how you would define architecture, as opposed to the very similar objects that can exist in contemporary art or design. In architecture, you have to have a client, because if not, the building just doesn't exist, doesn't get built. And I think even the works, hypothetical and extremely liberated works by Sotsas or by Archigram or Archizum or whoever, Buckminster Fuller, these projects that are entirely sort of world solutions are somehow still solutions. In other words, they have an idea of the client embedded in them, or of need. Whereas I think in contemporary art, you can make a structure, and this structure may create a problem. you know, may deliberately create a client for fun, but ultimately it's not seeking to please that client.
So you wanted the opportunity for whimsy, for your own whimsy, rather than fulfilling somebody else's notion of it?
Yes.
Which art would allow you in architecture, even if it is the fantasy architecture of Super Studio and Arcazoom wouldn't?
Yeah.
And so have you, to some degree, in your work as an artist, I mean, obviously artists have so many different motivations, and I'm sure yours are multiple, but to what degree is it enabling you to investigate, identify, and dwell upon the objects, the buildings, the environments that fascinate you?
Being within contemporary art, do you mean?
Being a practitioner.
I would say that I mean, compared to my architect friends, I get an awful lot of opportunities to actually make things. The life of a young architect, as we know, is extremely tough. Very, very, very few opportunities. And by the time that you get them, you know, by the time you get them, you've, in a sense, sold out most of your initial, you know, feelings and initial impulses. I mean, am I right in saying that, do you think?
I think for most architects that's the case. For a truly great architect, part of being truly great is that they withstand the inexorable forces of compromise, and so their vision does prevail. But it's certainly a much bolder, less nuanced vision than is possible in almost any other medium of expression. I mean, there's also, if you're actually going to build, there's the small but critical issue of it does actually have to stay up and not collapse.
And that is extremely, that's an extremely large component of an architect's training, which is one of the reasons why I sort of stopped doing it. As art, you never make work on the scale of a building. You have to accept that it's a smaller world. You have less immediate impact. I mean, any old building here has got more production budget than the most expensive Anish Kapoor in the world. You know, so already it's a different kind of size and conversation, but
some artists identify themselves as producing research-based work. Would you do so, or is actually the act of production and of realizing your ideas equally important to you?
The latter. And I have to say that I think that may be a generational matter, because I think that the likes of me and Spartacus Chetwynd, for example, who we went to college with, who also you may remember did a show here a couple of years ago, came after the Simon Starlings of the world. So we definitely grew up underneath them in a way, but.
Mm-hmm. So in other words, the process of production is, and the end result is, important to you too.
Well, I mean, I don't think I'm expecting a viewer to really be that interested in William Kent drapery style. I think in a way that the works are odd and decorative. And there is something for people that are more interested in that stuff. But there's a contextual game that I think I'm more interested in than in pure research. I mean, I find very, very heavily research-based art extremely plodding and really ungiving, and it's very few people. Simon Starling is one of the only ones that can actually turn it into something else.
So if we go back to your love of the Baroque, you've explained how the sort of the narrative of different objects really appeals to you. And yet often when you talk about your love of the Baroque, it is in aesthetic and emotional terms, in terms of its impact on those criteria. Is the historic context and the political subtext also important to you?
Yes. It is, but comparable objects in other situations wouldn't interest me. In other words, if I'm interested in the highly refined product of a group of people wanting to show their wealth and power, a high-end Apple computer does that as well as a Delft vase does that, but I lean towards the Delft vase. I think I'm interested in a particular sort of object that demonstrates its technological weaknesses to some extent. So I'm very interested in the beginnings of mass production, in pottery made to look better than it is, because of course Delftware is an imitation of Chinese, and they were desperately trying to emulate and copy this fantastic material that they had no idea how it was manufactured. So I'm interested in this sort of period of art.
So can you talk about another period that you're fascinated by is postmodernism, and particularly the sort of NAFA end of postmodernism, the sort of 80s commercialized postmodernism rather than the, here we are, hardcore core theory. So can you talk about how that interest arose, which was incredibly unfashionable when you...
Yes.
It was an important theme of your work.
It really was extremely unfashionable. And it's very strange how quickly time goes by. 15 years ago or so, or 10, the art climate was very, very different. Stephen Willatz was having a huge revival at the time, you know, and he would make these artworks that were, you know, kind of collages, very gritty, you know, kind of I can't get my pram up the council house esplanade kind of artworks, which are extremely valid, of course, but the kind of weird half celebratory, half critical look at postmodern design. The only people that I think were really interested in it at the time were fashion architecture taste, fat architects. And in the art world, absolutely no one. It was real taboo. And I remember talking in interviews where I would mention certain people, like Peter Greenaway, and they were edited out of conversation. They were literally just, they didn't make, you know, copy, because clearly editors very much, with my interests at heart, would realise that
saving
we had
to... from you as well. His later films were deeply
terrible,
dodgy.
Terrible, yes. But so I think that what I became interested in was these enormous sort of shrines to money that had decayed. The reason why I think I started to look at them, apart from the biographical reasons, which is I was brought up in Neasden, where essentially the newest buildings were sort of Pomo home base we had down the road. But the reason why I think I brought that in particularly was because I was asked to do a project by Polly Staple for Frieze projects. And this was at the point that everyone was completely crazy about the Frieze Art Fair, and it felt like London was a kind of epicenter of everything. And it almost felt as if it could go on forever, that this was the kind of dawn of a new age. And so I wanted to literally grab collectors and curators, take them from this sort of boom where everyone had a huge hard-on, and take them to these big lumps that were the remnants of a boom that had only collapsed 10 years previously, you know, and to say, look at this stuff, and then to bring them back. So yes, but on formal levels, I think I probably found a lot of interest in classicism through postmodern architecture.
But also, you did a wonderful little book on postmodern architecture in London, in which you almost produced sort of mini Joseph Gandhis, these fantastical realizations of the visions that the often very dodgy architects of these postmodern buildings, like Terry Farrell's, I forget whether it was MI5 or MI6, perhaps both, headquarters, that you drew the buildings, but also within the context of the fantasies that the architects might have had. You were aggrandizing some very weak architecture, reminiscent of the Thatcher era, which for obvious reasons was demonized in polite circles at the time. So was it the perversity that was at the root of its appeal, or was there anything more fundamental?
Well, I think that the... I think a few things about this. are worth pointing out. One is that the looking back at a recently deceased style is important to see the good as well as the bad. And very often, the further away you get, the better it is, the better we become at judging things. Like, for example, there's recent talk to list the, I think Zaha Hadid has given her backing to list the James Stirling number one poultry building. That was seriously demonised at the time.
Still is by myself, yes. I have to say. I opposed the listing.
And things like, for example, the TVAM headquarters, that was not given a listed status. I mean, I tried desperately to get it listed. I called them up and shouted.
I had no impact whatsoever.
None whatsoever. but, I mean, this is an undeniably important building.
And was actually a much more cheerful and also much more visible and discussed building at the time.
I agree, yes. And one it's the one with the egg cups in Camden Market. You may know it. But so the good and the bad, I think, needed to be in there together. There are some very good buildings in this, and some, like the Tate Britain extension, which is marvellous, I think.
Again, we disagree. Proceed.
And then I think another thing, aside from the contrarian, of course, at the time, the YBAs had fizzled away, or they were sort of entering the stratosphere either way. They were not so visible when I was a very young artist. The art landscape was in the hands of artists that were extremely, I wouldn't say worthy, but well-meaning, you know. Nils Norman, Simon Starling, these are good people. And I don't feel like a very good person very often, or I enjoy being a cunt, you know, and so I wanted to sort of highlight some of the aspects that I found naughty, you know, but I do acknowledge that I felt naughty at the time, so there is a dose of contrarianism. But I have to say that when you're a young artist, or when you're a young anyone, whether it's, you know, how you do your hair or not, you sort of project to what you think is an immediate future, and you think you're on the tip of the zeitgeist, you know, and I think that, you know, some people, you know, desperately move towards that, and some people, I don't know, hold themselves back, and I was desperately trying to search or felt that I had found this thing that was speaking about, even though it was about the past, it felt like it was really now, before it had become fashionable, and I was desperate to sort of to exploit it, to sort of dive in and discover all this stuff. I mean, you know, people weren't looking at it.
No, and also perhaps naively, I felt that, not that you had approached this with philanthropic zeal exactly, but that there was an underlying passion. So it wasn't an entirely cynical, I mean, you used the, you said you wanted to exploit it. I saw you more as championing it,
well, I don't,
which is less cynical.
Yes. Well, see, I think at the time I was championing it, I felt that this stuff was really, really worth looking at. And to be perfectly honest, I think I was quite right to champion it, because some of these buildings are being grade listed, you know, and people do, they do have their followers. But in hindsight, I think that my sort of interest in it all was like a kind of gold mine of making art. You know, this subject matter was just there, and it was just, you know, it was there to be used. I didn't have to worry about what, you know. I mean, that said, I may be sounding cynical, but quite frankly, there are immediate biographical reasons why I was in this land in any case. I mean, I could have chosen anything else. I could have chosen, you know, Tibetan rugs as a subject matter, and I didn't. So the fact that I was in that land was already...
So if we move on tangentially, one of the things I love about your work are the titles, which I assume you must have taken a strategic decision at a certain point in your career that you would give a great deal of thought to the titling of your work, and you would also have fun with it. So, for example, Alex referred to the beach huts in Folkestone earlier, and their title is Beach Hut in the Style of Nicholas Hawksmoor, which obviously sounds very formal, it's factually accurate, but there's a sort of wink and a wittiness to it. So was this something you dealt with strategically?
No. Well, not so much. I mean, I think that the when I started to make these works and drawings, I mean, I've always hated poetic titles, I have to say. But the subject matter, when you see it illustrated in books, was exactly that, you know. So you can go through old master drawing collections, and you know that drawing is called Design for Candelabra with Statuette to the Left. Done, you know. And that sort of seemed to solve all the problems. But I like those titles because there's a huge amount of breathing space in them, you know.
No, and they are playful and intriguing, and given that this project, it seems to me in many ways, it sort of encapsulates so many strands of your work. I mean, however accidentally it may have been that Nottingham Contemporary was in a position to commission an artist for this particular project, it does seem so beautifully made for you. What has been most surprising to you about it?
The most surprising thing is what a contemporary artist I am, how much of a contemporary artist I am. I've found the comfort with which I was in Nottingham Contemporary a real surprise, because never having really entered the world of tassels and pomanders, I thought that world was secretly a world of my calling, and actually it's not.
So the white cube is your domain,
I think,
after all.
I do need it, yes.
Right, with a few swags, of course, and thrones. And what are your next projects going to be?
I have a... there's a British art show coming up. I have a...
And are you doing new work for that?
I am.
Is it existing?
Yes, I'm, I think I'm actually quite hard to contextualise, as curators have always told me. As a way of saying sorry for not putting me in the big group show. And so little by little, I get included in these things. So I'm doing that, it's new work. There's a show at the Museo Marino Marini next year. I'm doing the Duveen Commission for Tate Britain, which is going to be a large-scale performance.
Great.
There's going to be a performance in James Sterling's Stuttgart.
Also a building I deeply dislike, and I'm sure you don't.
I'm only going to say this. Actually, I'm not even going to say it. No, I am. It's the best building of the latter half of the 20th
Ooh,
century.
Wrong. But, so for the Duveen Commission, will it just be a performance, or will there be structural elements as well?
There will be structural elements, and it's going to be quite closely related to the Via Appia drawings that I did. So it's essentially a sort of a reenactment of, say, the Forum of Ancient Rome. Of course, reenactment in so many ways, that's impossible, you know, but it would be a sort of ceremony of sorts that would have perhaps taken place there. Maybe, I'm not sure, we're in discussion about that.
So that's a very nice legacy of this exhibition and for people to bear in mind when they see
the Duveen. It's been very, very useful, I think, for me to do this show because I've had to try desperately to find new ways of showing objects and telling a narrative. I've had to just go into very new territory, which has been very useful.
Right. Well, on that note, I'm sure you've got questions for Pablo, whether it's about this exhibition or his work in general. So if there is anything you'd like to ask him, if you could raise your hand and wait for the roving mic to come round so it can be recorded.
No.
Ooh, big crackle.
It's okay. That's okay.
That all right? Yes. What struck me was a sort of a dynamic thing about your work. There seems to be an element of something of the context changing as one looks at your work. It's almost, you alluded to cartoons, I think, earlier. And one of the things that struck me about the Via Appia, and I've been there several times, is the fact that it is several things at once. As indeed the way the work is that you've selected and laid out follows that kind of pattern. If I just focus on one thing, which is the thing you'd called a temple could be a shrine, it could also be a mausoleum, it can also be a theatre. And in that sense, I think these are sort of elements that you seem to be playing around with in your work. And I just want to know what your comments on that, as an example of what I was getting at.
Well, I think that's a good observation. I think that the work is quite slippery because it's not exact. In other words, the classical references are entirely spurious. I mean, Quinlan Terry would die of a heart attack at this thing up here. But in terms of, if we're looking at this particular, the silver temple that's on screen now, I call it a silver temple, I think, because I assume, or I project back into the 17th or 18th century, and I imagine that presented to the Duke was a design for a silver temple. In other words, it doesn't immediately function as a temple for us. It's not how we would associate temple. But there is a historic precedent for describing it that. But it is a historic precedent for it to be described as a temple, rather than a current one, in a way. The interior is a buffet, basically. But we've done quite sort of odd things, like, for example, there is at the sort of at knee height, there is a false door painted dark green, which is in simulation of a lot of the garden ornament that was made for houses like Chatsworth, that would have temples that were in fact, you know, sort of tea houses or whatever it might have been. But overall, what I think happens with someone that isn't classically trained, and I'm definitely not classically trained, is that you become quite an opportunistic user of architectural detail. So, you know, you find that a pediment can just appear here or there or anywhere, really. And as long as the effect is achieved, then it's done. I get confused for classicists by people that really have no idea, but I think there isn't a single shred of accuracy in any of my work, really. So well spotted.
Thank you.
Question there.
Hello, good evening.
Hi.
Thank you very much for the conversation. Quite interesting. My question is about the Appian Way. I have noticed that you didn't include any human presence at all, and I was surprised because the series that you showed us, this connection between the human being and architecture. But I also noticed that most of the sections are really very white, and you know the materiality is almost like a vacuum, it's like a void. And I don't know if that's because it's a construction, a fictitious, or if I'm overreading, I don't know.
The cross-section elements to it are white because it is, in a paradoxical way, the most solid part. In other words, it's untraversable. And it is in continual material, the floor and the sides. This is within conventions of architectural draftsmanship. In the 18th century, all of that stuff would have been painted pink. And in other times in the 19th century, they would have probably painted it black, for example, or red, or however it varied. The human figure, I can't draw humans to save my life, but I do use them as scale measures. However, with something like the Appian Way, I wanted to show it entirely deserted. There's a fantastic description of ancient Rome in the 9th century, and I think it describes as there being essentially 800 people living in Rome because everyone else had died or moved away. And I was very interested in this scraps or shred of civilization clinging onto something.
A question there. Do you want to try the other microphone?
Thank you for your talk. To be honest, I would have been a bit more engaged in the relationship of the objects within Chatsworth House in general to a more conventional journey through history and change in society and culture and so on. But that aside, that's just sort of my interest. From memory, there's only one portrait as such in the items you have here. So do you want to expound on why that is the case?
The portrait that I chose, I think I chose because I found a very personal and immediate connection with the figure in it. In other words, I felt in that portrait that there was a shedding of paraphernalia. Despite the fact that there's a lot of detail around the figure, the face was by far the most important thing. There's a lot of historical portraits that are actually quite heraldic. In other words, the clothes are the most important thing, or the shield behind the sitter is the most important thing, or the celebrity of the artist is the celebrity of the sitter is the most important thing. So, for example, the portrait of Georgiana, Duchess of Devonshire, she's such a celebrity that in a way you're already embedded within a kind of, you know, a sort of myth of her person. And I think I was interested in every man in that sense. and I think the honest truth is that there aren't, I mean, Chatsworth is very, very well known for certain things. It's very known for Delft. It's extremely well known for its Old Master collection of drawings, but it's not very well known for its collection of paintings. And there are, of course, lots of paintings in Chatsworth, but when you're making an exhibition like this, you need real headliners. You need paintings by very famous people that are able to make the local press, bring people in, have people recognize the names, and there are few of those paintings at Chatsworth that are not Circle of, or School of, or Follower of so-and-so. And the house was the most obvious example of that.
Any more questions? Actually, I have one that relates to I'm not sure what medium you've used them in, but your vision of 17th century Chatsworth, devoid of the 18th and 19th century additions, because I must admit, whenever I've been there, I've mentally demolished, in particular, the 19th century wing, because the house did seem so perfect in its original form. Do you share, despite our difference of feeling on James Stirling, do you share that aversion?
I think yes, actually. I have to say that the 18th and 19th century additions to Chatsworth are very, very good quality architecture. But I sort of wanted to get back to this biscuit with a hole in it, donutty type thing, because it seemed to speak of a route, a very identifiable circular route, that was mirrored in our route around the furniture. But in architectural terms, generally, I find additions troubling. I sort of learn to celebrate them as I get older. But
so, are there any exceptions to that?
I think it depends on the sort of architecture. I very much like additions to Jacobean houses. You know, I just find that the sort of perfection of this sort of square at Chatsworth is too nice to sort of spoil. I mean, one of the reasons why postmodern architecture is so successful still is because of its ability to extend historic buildings. You know, I think that the... What do you think of the Venturi extension to the National Gallery, for example?
Well, first of all, I've always thought Wilkins' original National Gallery, Prince Charles got it so wrong, is a deeply mediocre building. I don't think Wilkins was a particularly interesting architect. And I also dislike the Venturi Scott Brown addition. You know, the galleries functionally don't work as spaces to show historic art. So there's always, when you come out of the sort of, at least Wilkins did give grand galleries to the building, when you come out of the historic galleries and then go down there, it has to be a really wonderful exhibition to overcome them. So I have always found it deeply disappointing. Mm. Yourself?
I find the facade extremely successful as an addition. But I agree.
Why?
I think
because it's discreet?
Because it sort of seeps into something else. And I think that architecturally that's quite a tough thing to do. But I agree, I think the interiors are weak. I mean, you know, especially the downstairs is a very weak exhibition space.
Yeah, and I can't see a sort of rational reason why.
No.
So any more questions for Pablo? One there.
Hi, thank you very much for all the discussion. May I ask a slightly provocative question? You say that you didn't want to become an architect because the architect has got a client to comply to. And you obviously are fascinated by architecture, but then you are fascinated by a period of architecture that is Baroque and then postmodernism, where the center is the ornament, while in other period, both the Classicist period and particularly the modernist period, we have that ornament, particularly in the modernist period, is sin. So architecture has got a function and has to respond to it. Art, what is your art about? What has it got a function? And you are fascinated with the real world, but inventing and representing a reinvention of the world, like in the Appian section. So what is actually an artist like you doing for the world?
Well, I mean, we are entirely within an art system. So, in a large way, very little. But within a world of exhibitions or museums or galleries, if that world is worth supporting, I'm probably one of the few people that's bringing in historic material from a particular period. So that is already something within a series of highly rigid conventions of contemporary art that is actually fairly different from what the vast majority of artists are doing. Whether that's good or bad is another matter. It's not for me to say. But I think that the question of, well, I'm afraid to say I think that the question isn't entirely clear, because I'm not entirely sure what the connection is between the role of the contemporary artist and the mention of Baroque architecture having a central focus and Classicism not. So I can't really answer your question until I understand it a little bit further.
Oh, sorry then. The point was mainly that the architecture period you are fascinated with is a period of contracts, a period where ornament becomes very important. And ornament is very important in visual art, while in certain period of architecture, for most of the history of architecture, ornament was secondary to architecture per se, while it becomes very important in postmodernism. And maybe many architects, sorry, I'm an architect, many architects don't like certain kind of architecture because it looks too much at the ornament and less to the function, because it's true that we build things that are useful for the people who live in, for the people who pass by, while art sometimes is just a visual enjoyment, and the artist tries or not doesn't try to interact with his public. Mm. So, well, in which way?
I mean, without wanting to sort of be too emotional about it, when you look at something like a Frans Hals painting, you understand deep human empathy. Now, no matter how good the architect is, it's very difficult for the layman to understand certain sorts of things from architecture. Of course, architecture is extremely useful, but art, if we talk about it in very general terms, is as crucial to humanity, because of course we can see other human beings communicating with each other and with ourselves. You know, it's as fundamental as a speech is, you know. So I don't know if it's possible to remove use from art in that way. But one thing that I think I should mention in relation to ornament is that I think we've got to be very careful when we're talking about modernism as being essentially not interested in or devoid of ornament, because from the 1970s onwards, there is a string of publications, some of which I think are really magisterial. There's a fantastic one called On Weathering, and there's another one called White Walls Designer Spaces. And these are books that really expose how ornamental, unornamented architecture actually is. So the white wall is, of course, a colour. It's not neutral. It's a paint surface on top of a wall. And it signifies to us neutrality, but of course, that's a convention. And it's a recent one. Alice, would you like to say anything about this?
Well, I think it's a germane question. It goes really to the function of art, which, for me, the critical importance of art is that artists articulate, sort of deconstruct the world and articulate ideas that the rest of us struggle to voice and to understand, particularly the sort of murkier, messier, more disturbing aspects of it. So particularly at a turbulent time like this, I think art has a fundamental role to play. But earlier, when I asked you about your motivations for your work, that wasn't something you voiced. But in many respects, I think there's a very sweet, old-fashioned aspect to your practice, and that you're exercising and representing your imagination, which is something that traditionally artists have done, and I think on a human level is a valuable thing to do. I mean, whenever I look at your work, I tend to think not of other artists and not of architects, but of the sort of architectural fantasists. I mean, people like Ledoux, Boulez, Joseph Gandhi's more fanciful architectural draftsmanship, like his masterpiece, The Ruins of John Soane's Bank of England, which also very cleverly showed every serious structural decision that John Soane made. I mean, I haven't read of you referring to them, and it always surprises me that you haven't. Are you interested in their work?
Well, the three people you've mentioned are probably my sort of top five sort of subject matter, you know, that I regularly look at, yes. I look at them too closely, probably, to refer to them directly. But I used to, when I was younger, I used to sort of, in titles, refer to them. But they seem to have sort of seeped into my subconscious a bit more. I mean, I think that the period of revolutionary France is a really sort of fascinating moment in architectural history, because it was a time in which architects were trying to they were trying to give name and voice to institutions that hadn't existed before. They were trying to create national identity. They were trying to create an image of a courthouse that responded to democratic institutions, for example. How does that, what does that look like? This is no longer a feudal society. And so I find those architects extremely creative and also, you know, more than paper architects, I think, because they were kind of social workers for society in a way.
But is there anything more than perversity in your apparent preference for historicists, for architects who express themselves, whether ornamentally or not, by drawing on the past, rather than striving to create something that's entirely new and absolutely of the present and an anticipated future, which for me, call me an old-fashioned modernist, but that is the romanticism of the modernist ideal.
Well, I think within the context of contemporary art, this stuff is not that common, you know, at the moment. If I were entirely within a sort of, take a drawing like this, for example, there is a sort of digital type feeling to some of that stuff. But
well, there is.
Directly there, yeah. But I think that there are conventions and conventions. I'm very much within a sort of a contextual world of contemporary art. There's no doubt about that. But there are mainstreams and rivulets and tributaries and all sorts of things. And I am not making mass-produced abstract paintings for the high end of the mass, you know, collector market. And so the relationship I have to the end product is a longer one. You know, it's one that will last through a practice. Other artists function in this way also.
Have you found that your work and its dissemination, its exhibition, has stimulated conversations? I mean, we became friendly because we share many common obsessions, even if we interpret them in different ways and have different preferences, which is why I always love talking to you. But has your work flushed out sort of fellow Baroque obsessives, or perhaps when it's the Divine at will?
Well, they're in all, yeah, they you do get, you know, the odd person that suddenly turns up at a private view and says, I own a Ledoux drawing, or whatever it might be. And they do exist. They're quite odd, you know, they're an odd bunch. I think the nice thing about the kind of work I do is that you get in contact with people that have related interests in a way. I had a very nice conversation with Selena Fox. Do you know her?
Mm-hmm.
She wrote this fantastic book called it's
Carry On Talking.
Yeah, and it'll come. It's called The Arts of Industry.
Household Gods, isn't it, in The Arts of Industry?
Is that what the full title is?
Mm.
In this book, you know, is described a very intimate relationship between commodity product and the development of, you know, industrial culture in England. And I think I get to talk to her because of the kind of work I do, you know, and likewise you and whoever it might be. I don't get to talk to the billionaire Russian oligarch collectors, unfortunately for me.
I think fortunately. So, and then we'll come to you.
I was just thinking in relation, oh, thank you for your talk, it was wonderful. I was just thinking in relation to this gallery, particularly how you would relate to, or if you want to relate to, kind of a non-arts audience, so a different kind of cultural tourism, so people who've perhaps happened upon the gallery because they're interested in the collection. And I'd be particularly interested in your thoughts in relation to the pedagogy of the museum.
In relation to the...
kind of the learning function of the museum.
I have to say that that's really not something that I really know that much about, to be perfectly honest. I'm not a very didactic person. I mean, I think that there is mass appeal to these objects. I think that when you see the silver mast, you may think it's a kind of Jeff Koons level of vulgarity, which some viewers will, or you may really admire the workmanship. But I think that everyone, literally everyone in town, will have a reaction to that. And I, you know, I don't make work for a small clique. I never have. And I'm not interested in that kind of art practice. I am very happy to enter large-scale conversations with museums and with galleries, with publications where the wider world is invited in. But I'm not that expert. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that more, because I just don't know what, you know, what the educational function of a museum like this might entail, you know.
Well, if I try and interpret the question in a slightly different way, do you think there's a value for people to look at the, given that some people will be attracted to the exhibition, which does have the treasures of Chatsworth in very big letters on the poster, and they'll see the Delftware from the window, undoubtedly some visitors will be attracted to the exhibition because of the objects. Do you think it is valuable for them to see them in a different context?
Well, I think I want to answer sort of that question in two parts. One is to say that it's not necessarily guaranteed that the mention of Chatsworth will necessarily increase visitor numbers, because, I mean, this museum has very, very healthy attendance figures in any case. With a very, very contemporary programme, I do not know whether Frans Hals or Rembrandt are necessarily a draw to people. I mean, that's a bit of a, you know, question mark. We shall see. What was the second?
Well, the question is whether you feel it's valuable for people to see
the
objects in a different context, given that, I mean, you've done all these different, created these different mise-en-scene for them, some more overtly ironic than others. So do you think that people who might be drawn in thinking, what a splendid piece of Delftware, I must investigate further, that by seeing it in a different context, that will be valuable to them?
Very little of that, actually. That's a sort of by the by. It's not my intention at all. In fact, I think that a lot of the objects that we've gone for are actually objects that Chatsworth are perfectly well-versed in loaning, for example. They've travelled, some of these objects have travelled all over the world. Some of the silver is world-famous silver, and it's, you know, been on loan to quite a few places, I'm sure. I mean, this is the biggest loan to date that they've done to a UK institution, but these objects are very, very well-known outside of the immediate Chatsworth circle in any case. I put these objects to scenic use and vice versa, but do I care whether people gasp at the quality of a you know, Boule pedestal? No, not enough.
Boule, not Boule.
Yeah,
you're
exactly.
Missing the extra E. So we have one more question up there.
Thanks, and thank you very much indeed, Pablo, for the exhibition, which I've enjoyed hugely, and for this evening's talk as well. But I was interested in a a point of detail, really, about the selection of one of the objects in the show. I think that the contribution of Kent towards English design is possibly quite well captured by the flamboyant chairs that are in the show. But I was less convinced that Inigo Jones was done justice. I think that there's a rather fabulous collection of Inigo Jones drawings at Chatsworth, and it just struck me as rather odd that this not particularly good drawing was what made it, or what I feel to be a not particularly good drawing or interesting drawing, made it into the show. Mm. What was the thinking behind the selection of that particular piece?
Well, actually, it's quite odd that I take your point. Inigo Jones is very important to the history of English architecture, there's no doubt, but the reality is that all there are drawings. Now, we have a very limited amount of space that is controllable in terms of its lighting to the level that these very, very impressive drawings are able to be shown at. So, for example, where you show drawings, you can't show or illuminate in a certain kind of way. So we were very limited. Now, Inigo Jones is someone that is of vast appeal to architects and to people that like design and design history and stage history. But it's not a name that will necessarily make the list of the great and the good in a show like this. And so there are very practical considerations when you're mounting a very, an important show of impressive works that you hope will bring in other people, and Rembrandt has to be in. I don't particularly love the Rembrandt drawing. I've used it for my own purposes within the show. I'd much prefer some of the Inigo Joneses, but we can't entirely have Inigo Jones and Miss Rembrandt out or Miss Romano out because these are, more famous names, basically. But the aside from that, which is a whole other conversation, and it's a conversation that I've had to learn very quickly about because I'm not a curator, and these are questions that curators and museum directors deal with on a daily basis, and I'm not an expert in that, so I had to sort of sit down and say and learn from experts like Alex or like people at Chatsworth, that's a great drawing, but it's a weird, funny rock sketch, and no one is going to get it other than you, or other than a group of 5 or 10 people that might particularly like that rock drawing, so let's open it out a little bit. So I had to learn quite quickly that stuff. Why this particular Inigo Jones drawing is because I love it. I'm a complete sucker for this drawing. I think it is, I've said it in the past when I've been walking people around it, it's my favorite drawing in the show. It's probably my favorite piece in the show. I think it is a deeply romantic, wonderful, serene drawing that captures a lot of the, for me, a lot of the mystery of early opera, a lot of the sort of slightly sort of sexualized nocturnal world of the Jacobean and the Restoration Court. It for me, it says an awful lot that very sophisticated Inigo Jones or William Kent or Talman drawings that they have in their, and they've even got Palladio drawings, would have said, what else to say about that? William Kent, I think in this context, there is probably an elaborate connection to the Burlingtons later on. So that the for Kent to have a presence within the show is extremely important because there is an elaborate but very important series of sort of connections between the architect and the family later on into the 18th century.
Well, yeah. I love it. It's a fairly compelling answer. Now, we have run out of time, or are about to, but I think you've been... Is there one more question there? So this is the last question. Thank you.
Well, given that we're running out of time, it's a bit awkward, I should try and be succinct. I suppose my question really relates to my two neighbours here, their questions, and to an extent, Alice's, one of Alice's comments. And I'm actually almost decided not to ask a question because your response to some things tonight has actually riled me in the end. So I thought maybe it's better not to speak. But so Danielle, I'm very interested in, so I was in, came here tonight really to understand how it is and why it was that this exhibition was here. I've seen the exhibition and I thought, okay, this is, okay, it does seem slightly incongruous to be here. And then I was interested in the conceptual underpinning, let's say. And so, yeah, you talked throughout, like you mentioned, the power came up a lot. You talked about the finitude of power. You talked about perversity, some of your pieces are perverse, and the display of wealth. You talked about like decontextualization, and that maybe by moving these objects out of their usual setting, that maybe you were trying to say something quite powerful by that, whether there was something perhaps subversive by putting them in the white wall space. And then your response to the question in front of me was, oh yeah, what's the function of an artist? And it's essentially I won't try and paraphrase your answer, but yeah. So I don't know, do you think maybe there's a moral responsibility in the artist to try and do something meaningful with their art and maybe try and sort of, yeah, a moral, yeah, something might behove you to do something beyond maybe just entertain?
Well, I think there is an obligation to do something more than entertain. My answer to the question from the architect in front of you was to say that art is a way of communicating or dealing with very, sometimes very specific and sometimes very general questions and in quite a provocative way. I think that the overall contextual issue within contemporary art means that this show is actually quite different. Very different, in fact, to what you might regularly see in a contemporary art museum. Whether it does things like this successfully or not is really up to everybody to decide. But the reason why this show comes about isn't because I decide to work with Chatsworth House and say, I want to borrow all of this stuff. And that conversation is something that I've had to negotiate. Whether I would have put in a request for a grant and done a, you know, proposal on my own to deal with the collection of a country house, no, I wouldn't have. But I was asked very specifically to pair up with these objects and to bring them in. So I'm in that sense responding to a brief.
So to finish, I'd actually like to ask Alex, because I imagine other people will have similar questions when they see the exhibition. They will find it incongruous to be here. So I wondered what the response to the exhibition has been. Have people been puzzled to see the treasures of Chatsworth at Nottingham Contemporary? And what impact do you think it will have in the long term on Nottingham Contemporary as an institution?
I don't have a full sense of the audience response yet. You know, there's usually a kind of first flush of an opening, and people say things then, which is often a little bit different from perhaps the general reception and the course of the exhibition. I hope, perhaps even more so than most our exhibitions, that it will surprise. And I hope these recontextualizations will prompt people to think about both those objects, but also the environment they're brought into. And you know, I say that being very aware that I can't really put my finger on anyone other than Pablo who could perform that. So you know, this invitation really began with his work, really. And I think in many ways the larger grand tour, the loose grand tour concept of teaming up contemporary artists with great collections in these two counties, you know, partly follows from Pablo's precedent. And as soon as we had this opportunity to work with Chatsworth, as soon as I could see it being on the horizon, I immediately thought of Pablo. So Pablo wasn't, if you like, a solution to a problem. you know, the goal was very much Pablo and the Devonshire collection here. It was that triangulation that I think his practice on so many occasions has anticipated. You know, in terms of reception, in terms of audience, I hope that that will create a kind of cross-pollination of audience, and that that will reflect the cross-pollination going on in what Pablo's done, you know, what these maneuvers are about. And in terms of the legacy for the institution, how the program's thought, I mean, it's probably too early to say, but, you know, I hope it would suggest that there are, in a sense, no parameters, or should be no parameters, to what contemporary art can address and how it can address it, which I hope is, you know, perhaps ultimately what, for those of us that are most drawn to it and drawn, you know, if we're in a fortunate position to work with it, is its ultimate appeal.
Thank you. Well, as Pablo has explained, aspects of this exhibition will be something of a prelude for his Devine Commission at Tate Britain next year. So that's something to look forward to see another iteration of these ideas there. And for me, this has been a really provocative and intriguing exhibition to come to see, that has made me think very differently about the objects, treasures of Chatsworth, as they are. So thank you very much, a huge thank you to Pablo for answering all the questions so patiently and eloquently. Thank you very much to Alex and his team, who've organised this so well and looked after us so well. As Alex explained, there will be a big reveal as wine emerges from the curtain back there, so I think you're all invited
and thank you to Alice. Who is extremely busy. I do not know how we managed to lure you away from your hectic schedule, so thank you very much.
Happily to the home of Robin Hood. So thank you very much to all of you. Thank you. Oh, my goodness, that's very dramatic. Well done.
Thank you very much. You made it so easy. Thank you.